Let's look into testing a hypothesis about the population mean when sampling from a normally distributed population. And the question I'm going to look at here is, should we use a t-test or a z-test? Suppose we are sampling from a normally distributed population, and we wish to test the null hypothesis that the population mean is equal to some hypothesized value, mu naught. If the population standard deviation sigma is known, then we would use this z-test statistic. And if the null hypothesis is true, this z-test statistic has the standard normal distribution. But in the real world, it would be very rare that we would know the value of sigma. And so we replace the value of sigma, the population standard deviation, with our sample standard deviation. And we get a very similar test statistic, but something fundamental has changed in the underlying mathematics. And this t statistic does not have the standard normal distribution. If the null hypothesis is true, this test statistic will have a t distribution with n minus 1 degrees of freedom. I've looked at the similarities and differences between the t-distribution and the standard normal distribution elsewhere, but let's do a brief recap. The curve in white is the standard normal distribution, and the curve in red is a t-distribution with 2 degrees of freedom. Both the standard normal distribution and the t-distribution are symmetric about zero and bell-shaped, but the t-distribution has heavier tails and a lower peak. Here I have a t-distribution with 2 degrees of freedom, but as those degrees of freedom increase, the t-distribution tends toward the standard normal distribution. So let's see what happens when we increase those degrees of freedom. Here's a t-distribution with 10 degrees of freedom, with 15, with 20, and that t-distribution is getting closer and closer to the standard normal. The degrees of freedom are a function of the sample size. Here, the degrees of freedom are n minus 1. And so if we have a large sample size, the degrees of freedom will be large, and the t-distribution will be very close to the standard normal distribution. And so some sources say that if the sample size is greater than 30, just forget all about that t-distribution and just use the standard normal distribution. But if you are taking statistics with me, forget you ever heard such a thing. And many others feel the same way as well. If it is truly a t-statistic, we should be using the t-distribution. Let's look at a quick example to illustrate the differences. Suppose we are sampling 35 values from a normally distributed population, and we wish to test the null hypothesis that the population mean is 100 against a two-sided alternative. The sample mean and sample standard deviation are found to be 104 and 12, respectively. Since we have a sample standard deviation, our standard deviation is calculated based on sample data, we should be using the t statistic, and our t statistic is x bar minus mu naught over s over the square root of n. And in this case, that's 104 minus the hypothesized value of 100 over 12 over the square root of 35. And that works out to 1.972. Here our sample size is 35, and so the degrees of freedom, being n minus 1, are 34 in this case. Our alternative hypothesis is two-sided, and so the p-value is going to be the area in the tail beyond this test statistic doubled under a t-distribution with 34 degrees of freedom. Here I've plotted out in white a standard normal distribution, and in red a t-distribution with 34 degrees of freedom. They look very close, but you may still be able to tell that the t-distribution has slightly heavier tails and a lower peak. Let's split those up and find the p-value. Here's our t-distribution with 34 degrees of freedom, and the observed value of our test statistic was 1.972. And our alternative hypothesis was two-sided, so the p-value is this area in the tail beyond the test statistic doubled. And if we went to computer software, we would see that the correct p-value here using the t-distribution is 0.0568. Had we said, well, our sample size is greater than 30, so let's forget about the t-distribution and go to the standard normal distribution, and we put in the value of our test statistic there at 1.972, we got the area in the tail here beyond the test statistic and doubled it, we would have found the incorrect p-value based on the standard normal distribution of 0.0486. Now that's a little bit smaller than the correct p-value based on the t-distribution. Granted, they're fairly close, but I would say that that difference that we see is a meaningful difference. Here, if we use the standard normal distribution to find the p-value, we would be overstating the evidence against the null hypothesis. This difference will get smaller and smaller as the sample size gets larger and larger, but we might as well use the correct distribution. And so I suggest, and it's a point of view shared by many others, that if we have a t-statistic, we should find the p-value based on the t-distribution, and not simply say, well, we have a large enough sample size, so the standard normal distribution is good enough. On a final note, in practice we carry out the analysis using software, and here's the output for the example. Regardless of whether there are 2 degrees of freedom, 34 degrees of freedom, or 1,000,000 degrees of freedom, if the test statistic is calculated using the sample standard deviation, the software will find the p-value using the t-distribution with the appropriate degrees of freedom.